University of Houston, Cullen College of Engineering, Department of Mechanical Engineering, we welcome you to tonight's event. We are delighted to have with us Dr. John LIENHARD, whom all of us know as the host of the Engines of Our Ingenuity. Dr. LIENHARD is an author, professor emeritus of mechanical engineering and history at the University of Houston. He received his BS and MS degrees from Oregon State College and the University of Washington, his PhD from the University of California at Berkeley, and he holds two honorary doctorates. He has performed research in the thermal sciences as well as in cultural history. He is an honorary member of the American Society of Mechanical Engineers and a member of the National Academy of Engineering. In addition to many awards for his technical contributions, Dr. LIENHARD has received for his work on the engines, among other honors, the ASME Ralph Coates Rowe Medal for contributions to the public understanding of technology, the 1991 Fortune Division Award from the American Woman in Radio and Television, and the 1998 American Society of Mechanical Engineers Engineer Historian Award, as well as two Crystal Microphone Awards. The breadth of his interest is demonstrated by the wide range of topics covered in the Engines of Our Ingenuity, from Baroque violins, ice cream, and DC-3s, to the Spanish moss, to food in the Old Republic of Texas, the Republic of Porkdom. Clearly, no topic is off limits. But what's even more fascinating about Dr. LIENHARD is the intricacy and perhaps even more the passion with which he explores every one of these topics. So I think tonight we're in for a real treat. Tonight's topic, the Romantics versus Rationalism, and a new view of invention. Technology, invention, and science made their greatest steps forward just after the 18th century Industrial Revolution. Why? Let us look at factors that led to huge leaps in creative output during the 19th century. So ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, please join me in welcoming Dr. John LIENHARD.
Well, thank you. And it is a treat to be here. At the same time, it is daunting to be asked to speak to a group on how to tap into human ingenuity. For that is really the great mystery of the ages. How do we bridle the creative demon, if I may call him that? Bear in mind, that is a demon that we cannot live without. We are the only species completely dependent on invention. We can't graze grass or catch prey with our teeth. We can't survive in cold climates without clothing or shelter that we've built. Go down the line. We are a species that is evolved to be completely dependent upon invention. But essential as invention is, it never fails to bring with it change and disruption. So, invention is unwelcome. The situation is paradoxical. It is the ultimate catch-22. So, we've been schizoid about invention. Down through history, we try to encourage it, we try to stifle it. And we shrink from the very word invention, if you stop and think about it. We replace it with that weasel word, innovation. Innovation literally means what? Just a little bit of invention to improve what's already there. It means to make new some technology that's already in place. It means don't stick your neck out too far. Invention is too raw. It's too close to our inner psyche. Talking about invention in polite society is like talking about sex. Nice people don't. All we utter publicly is that wishy-washy word, innovation. So, let's go to a special time when we broke through the barriers of restraint and propriety, a time when we reinvented invention itself.
And to do that, I'd like to quote a passage from Coleridge's Kubla Khan. Now, Coleridge wrote Kubla Khan in 1797, but he didn't publish it until 19 years later, in 1816. And those dates bracket the most remarkable time in the history of Western ideas. Coleridge began with a 3.5 verse paean to Kubla Khan's pleasure palace. And then he broke off abruptly with his vision and really introduced his vision of an inventive demon. And who was that demon? We're not sure. Was it the writer of the poem? Was it the builder of Xanadu? Maybe it was that creative force that goes far beyond the poem or the palace. Anyway, here's how Coleridge finishes. I would build that dome in air, and all should cry, beware. Beware his flashing eyes, his floating hair. Weave a circle round him thrice, and close your eyes with holy dread. For he on honeydew hath fed, and drunk the milk of paradise. I pointed out that we have good reason to beware of invention, to beware that creative demon. Coleridge was deadly earnest about both its fearfulness and about the importance of releasing it in our lives. He wrote a letter to his friend Tom Poole in 1801. That was 4 years after he wrote the poem and 15 years before he published it. He says to Poole, "Deep thinking is attainable only by a man of deep feeling. All truth is a species of revelation." He goes on to tell Poole that he's been studying Newton. It's hard going, but he's delighted with the beauty and neatness of Newton's experiments. He also likes Newton's immediate deductions, but then he gets to his point. Newton's overall vision, he said, is so superficial. In Newton's system, the mind is always passive. It's a lazy onlooker on an external world. Now, those are pretty harsh words for Newton, who was by then practically deified. I expect most of you have heard lines from an earlier poet, Alexander Pope. Pope eulogized Newton earlier in the 18th century with his famous, "Nature and nature's laws lay hid in night. God said, let Newton be, and all was light." Well, for Pope, nature's laws lie there to be found. For Coleridge, all truth is a species of revelation. Coleridge clearly saw a far greater role for the human mind to play in formulating science or building technology. He and the other Romantic poets were saying something very odd to scientists around them. They said, the Romantics said, that we must create nature by dreaming nature. Now that sounds pretty weird to our ears, but many engineers and scientists of that period caught on. They understood and they responded. The Romantics realized that after Newton, science had gone down the path of observation, organization, and obedience to the rules of math and deduction. Fine so far, but science had downplayed insight and invention. Engineers were especially well equipped to break away and follow the Romantics' lead. After all, what is a machine? It's a Platonist reality formed in the mind. The actual iron and brass out there, that's only a corporeal shadow of a mental reality. Example, James Naismith, born in 1808 in Scotland. He grew up to become an engineer in the new industrial world. His father, Alexander Naismith, was an artist. In fact, he's the artist who founded the Scottish School of Landscape Painting. But the father had also invented the lightweight iron bridge, a new kind of rivet, and a whole lot of other things. Young James was raised in his father's workroom. He grew up in a place where the artist's mental images met the material means for making things. James Naismith made a life's work of turning the dreams of the 18th Industrial Revolution into the heavy machinery of the 19th century, and yet he'd studied art before he studied engineering. In 1840, he produced a great steam hammer to forge the new steamship engine shafts, which were steamships were just coming into being at that point. A decade later, that marvelously agile forge drew crowds at the Crystal Palace exhibition, and Naismith told how he invented it. He said, "Following this idea, I rapidly sketched out my steam hammer, having it all clearly before me in my mind's eye." So, look deeper at the process that spawned a lifetime of creating heavy machine equipment, and we find the imprint of the artist's eye. His sketchbook reveals words and fragments of machinery and calculations that all look disordered at first, but then we catch the progression from the inner eye to the outer world. We see the sense of beauty that drives invention. Naismith erased the line between art and thing entirely. Great engines marched out of his head onto his notebooks and then off into the new machine-powered world. And when he was done, he turned about and rendered his finished machine back into an oil painting. I guess he was actually taking the dream back into his mind where it was born. He quite literally created nature by dreaming nature, then turned around and, in Jung's words, honored the dream. When you're on Google, Google Naismith and steam forge, and you can actually see that particular painting. We read the same influence of the Romantics in the great physicist John Tyndall. Tyndall, born in Ireland in 1820, before he took up physics, he designed steam railway systems. And all his life, he was drawn like a moth to the flame of Romantic poetry. His physics lay squarely between these two powerful forces, the material engines of external reality and the inner engine of the Romantic mind. He made constant reference to the wild forces of nature, which was a Romantic conceit. His physics grew lyrical when he described glaciers or the erratic behavior of flames. Listen to this curious sentence from the preface to his text on heat. "I've tried to show how physics passes from the world of the senses to a world where vision becomes spiritual, where principles are formed and from which the explorer emerges with concepts to be approved or rejected as they coincide with sensible things." In other words, he was bending our usual view of science and the scientific method to the language of the Romantics. The scientist, he said, starts out in the realm of physical senses, but the creative act of shaping sense data into concept is a spiritual one. Then we must bring concept back down off the mountain, back to the hard earth, and there we have to put it to the test. So, inventors and scientists saw what the Romantics meant. Just as a poem or a machine is a reality first shaped in our minds, so too is our concept of nature. They asked, what, after all, is nature before our minds give it its shape? Poets may have helped us to revise our whole sense of our creative selves 200 years ago in this way. But, so far, none of this addresses the question that has been placed before me, how do we access invention? Well, the Romantics had an answer to that one as well. Example, 1816. That was the year Coleridge published Kubla Khan. It was the same year that Mary Wollstonecraft went off with Lord Byron and her husband-to-be, Percy Shelley, to summer over in Switzerland. And she writes her own experience of inventing the story of Frankenstein there. This is in the preface to her 1919 edition, as I remember. What she says makes a fine tutorial on creative thinking. I want you to listen as she writes a complete theory of invention. Everything she begins must have a beginning. That beginning must be linked to something that went before. The Hindus give the world an elephant to support it, but the elephant stands on a tortoise. Invention is not created out of the void, but out of chaos. The materials must first be there. What were the materials that she worked with? Well, she goes on. Many and long were the conversations between Lord Byron and Shelley. During one of these, the principle of life was discussed, whether it could ever be discovered. They talked of the experiments of Dr. Darwin, who preserved a piece of vermicelli till by some extraordinary means it began to move. Well, of course, we know now that maggots were growing in his vermicelli, but never mind, they didn't. Perhaps a corpse could be reanimated. Galvanism hints of such things. Perhaps the component parts of a creature might be manufactured, brought together, and endued with vital warmth. In the most arresting part of her account, Shelley tells how her story formed from the chaos of their conversation that night. Night waned upon this talk, she says. Even the witching hour had gone by. When I placed my head on my pillow, I did not sleep, nor could I be said to think. My imagination, unbidden, possessed and guided me, gifting the successive images that arose in my mind with a vividness far beyond the usual bounds of reverie. I saw with shut eyes but acute mental vision a pale student of the unhallowed arts kneeling beside the thing he had put together. I saw the hideous phantasm of a man stretched out and then, on the working of some powerful engine, show signs of life and stir with an uneasy, half-vital motion. And how would Victor Frankenstein react, she wonders. And so she tells us, success would terrify him. He would rush from his odious handiwork, horror stricken. He would hope that slight spark of life would fade, that this thing would subside into dead matter. He falls into sleep, but he wakes. The horrid thing stands by his bedside, opening his curtains and looking at him with yellow, watery, but speculative eyes. Well, we all experience that moment of conscious detachment just before we sleep. And as Mary Shelley reached that moment, she was still replaying the evening's conversations in her mind. Suddenly, in that strange land between waking and sleeping, bits of talk fused into one of the finest tales of horror we know. The romantic poets that Mary Shelley ran with used the word reverie to describe that state. And being able to access reverie is profoundly important. I had a fine lesson in that process some years ago. I was in Houston's Museum of Fine Arts, letting my mind wind down, gradually putting the workaday churn behind me. When I got to the exhibit of modern Texas art, I asked the security guard, "With all the hours you spend here, which is your favorite work?" "Sir," he said, "as a matter of policy, we don't express opinions on the art." Then he smiled and said, "I'm going to break that rule and tell you, actually, I like all the art." So I laughed at his self-deprecatory, fool-nobody diplomacy. It put me kind of in the right frame to enjoy the good humor of modern art. When he passed again, I said, "Someday you're going to be president of the United States." He pulled a long face. "Now, why should you have such a low opinion of me?" notice, I do not say when this happened. Then he added, "I need to give you the real answer to your question. The finest art in this room is not hanging on the walls. It's the people who come through here. People aren't the same in here as they are walking through the supermarket, you know. They're different. They're open. They come here to be changed." And I was astonished. You know, of course, that's what it was all about. He'd gone right to the center of it. Long ago, Louis Pasteur talked about creativity. He said, "Chance favors only the prepared mind." But Pasteur offered no guidance as to how we prepare our minds. That security guard did give us guidance, and very good guidance. People don't move through museums the way they move through supermarkets. Art is a lot more than a product just served up for our pleasure. It is a trigger to our imaginations. We all live in need of ideas. We all have problems to solve. At some point, most of us catch on to the fact that when our problems need creative solutions, They cannot be attacked with purely methodical tools. Method takes us down familiar roads. We need to see the shrubbery-shrouded side roads that we ignore by habit. The hardest thing we do is leave the highway and float above the land. Music, theater, sculpture, the movies, they all cut us loose from the road of method and common sense. The so-called creative leap is not a leap in the dark without antecedents or stimulus. Rather, it happens when we find a liminal state on the very edge of awareness, a state where ideas arrive without order or hierarchy. In that mental world, cow paths become just as important as freeways. Our security guard realized how inside the museum we lay aside our shopping list of needs to be met. Here was a place where it was possible to leave our supermarket lives and go wandering in the woods. He'd seen people who'd left their lists outside and were ready to be taken into alien spaces, into byroads of thought. The places close at hand that we didn't know were there. Yet, we all have to carry that process over into our high-pressure world. And that's not easy. Jean-Paul Sartre said something that I think captures that need with great accuracy. He said, "Let us not look for the door and the way out anywhere but in the wall against which we are living. Instead, let us seek respite where it is, in the very thick of battle." In other words, we have to find mental repose right in the middle of the marketplace. But how do we harness the creative moment of reverie? That is the great desideratum we all want, if we could only bottle it and sell it. And I think you'll find a lot of people out there who are selling it in bottles. Never mind. In 1976, 31 creative scholars had a try at figuring this out. They were called to Sigtuna, Sweden for an odd seminar. There they talked and wrote personally and self-revealingly, and the seminar organizers asked them to free associate, and they did. They looked for commonality in the way they worked, and finally, they listed 5 stages of the creative process. Here I give you a list. God help me. First, number 1, the arrival of the idea. 2, sharing the idea, exposing it to criticism by trusted friends. 3, the hard work of analysis, fleshing out and testing the idea. 4, creating a language of exposition, learning to teach the idea to others. Watch that one, it's a trap. 5, going public with the developed idea. Now, I mentioned the marketplace a moment ago, the need to stay anchored in the real world of pressure and problems. So notice here how these stages move back and forth from public to private, from solitary to social. All the participants wrote sometimes poignantly about the tension between needs for intellectual companionship and needs for isolation. Most had a great deal to say about places. They all spoke of walks, neighborhoods, cafes, libraries, bookstores. They all craved creative solitude. Each had some special place of quiet. Often that place was a personal office, or it could be a place occupied by other people. One geographer said, "Although I'm a loner, I do not like to be alone. I further my creative dreamlike thinking by being alone in big, peaceful crowds. I like to mix with people moving on the main streets, looking at things, seeing faces." The place changed with the creative stage. In stage 1, these people had means for claiming that dream state, that reverie. Ideas arrived in a peculiar loneliness, fed by beauty of one sort or another. Sometimes it was the beauty of remote nature. Sometimes it was the beauty of the presence of other people. But their new ideas immediately needed community nurture. In stage 2, We call on those we trust to help us breathe life into our idea. Without human contact, it's going to die. Stage three, the analytical stage. Now, this is again lonely. The place has to be familiar, comfortable workplace, a place where thought is uninterrupted. But the analyzed and tested idea that comes out of that place, that is far from complete at this point. Stages four and five deal with privately preparing the idea and then delivering it to a wider, less comfortable public. Notice, what all of this does to the myth of the lonely intellectual. Creativity, with its need for retreat and isolation, needs the nourishment of community. But the Sigtuna participants identified two kinds of community. First was the close, comfortable kind, and make no mistake, that's absolutely needed for this process to work. The Sigtuna group treasured that sort of community, even when it was a community they didn't interact with. Poet William Butler Yeats caught the sense of that kind of community wonderfully well in a short poem about his own creative process. I'll read it. It's only two stanzas. My 50th year had come and gone. I sat a solitary man in a crowded London shop, an open book, an empty cup on the marble tabletop. While on the shop and street I gazed, my body for a moment blazed, and 20 minutes more or less it seemed so great my happiness that I was blessed and could bless. Now, he wrote almost a century later than the Romantics, but here is he perfectly captures the kind of creative reverie that they spoke about. The other kind of community, equally important, is that of harsher critics. And taking it on is the last stage. One thing I encounter constantly is the inventor who's challenged that community, entered stage five, without properly finishing stage four. You all know people who've been chewed up and spat out by that world out there, a world that has not been convinced. I receive emails all the time from misunderstood inventors that don't understand me. I have to tell them over and over that any inventor is the enemy of the establishment. If they've neglected to do all the needed diplomacy, they will be received as enemies. That simply the world is wired together. It is, in fact, the way things should be. We'd all spout nonsense if there were no breaks on our sense of creativity. Now, one more case history to illustrate the Romantics' insistence on the primal importance of finding space where our minds can float. This is physicist Hans von Baer's story about the benzene molecule. It begins in 1850 with young architecture student Friedrich Kekulé. Kekulé is testifying before a grand jury in Gießen, Germany. The charred body of a neighbor lady has been found in her burned-out room. People thought she was the victim of spontaneous combustion brought on by drinking too much liquor. She apparently was something of a dipsome. The great chemist Justus von Liebig was called to testify, and he made it quite clear that the lady would have died long before she'd drunk enough alcohol to make her flammable. Then Kekulé's testimony incriminated a servant who had been stealing from the lady. He identified her distinctive ring, which turned up in the servant's possession. Together, Liebig's and Kekulé's testimony convicted the scoundrel of murdering the lady and stealing from her. The trial left its mark on the young Kekulé. He gave up architecture and he took up the study of chemistry with Liebig. The old lady's odd ring also lingered in Kekulé's mind. That ring carried the old alchemy seal showing two intertwined serpents biting each other's tails. 15 years later, Kekulé worked with Liebig on the new chemical benzene. The rules of chemical combination, which had been pretty well worked out by then, made it clear that benzene had to be an arrangement of 6 carbon and 6 hydrogen atoms. But how, in the name of common sense, can you arrange such a molecule without violating the rules of chemical valence? Hydrogen has two bonds, carbon has four, I'm sorry. You might sit down and try that yourself if you don't know the answer already. It seemed impossible. Then one night, Kekulé dozed in his chair by the fire trying to solve the riddle. He nodded, half waking, half sleeping, and dreamt of the twining serpents on that old ring whirling in the flames. And suddenly the serpents caught each other's tail and formed a circle, and Kekulé saw the answer. The carbon atoms formed a hexagonal ring with alternating single and double bonds. Each carbon held its own hydrogen atom as well. Like charms on a bracelet, says von Baer. That was a structure completely alien to anything known in chemistry at that point. We're seldom given such a clear account of the moment an idea reveals itself. And two things come out of Kekulé's story. One was the importance of bringing new tools to the table. Kekulé's architectural, spatial, and structural sense gave him a place to stand outside the current practice of analytical chemistry. It gave him another way of looking at things. But he also had that terribly important ability to let the problem he was working on into his subconscious mind. He was able to turn his dreams loose upon it. The problem is, that is not a lookup procedure. Every fiber of our being wants to move in a straight line toward the answers we need. We want, we expect to deduce answers. But invention is the fruit of recognition. It is not the fruit of deduction. And I repeat Pasteur's wonderful remark that chance favors only the prepared mind. What's astonishing is just how much stuff floats by if we only have the wits or the positioning to catch it. In any case, by the end of the 19th century, the Western world had not only built the greatest technological empire the world had ever seen, physics had taken, I think, the largest single leap forward that it ever has, led by a breed of scientists, Maxwell, Boltzmann, Gibbs. The century ended with the rise of Planck and Einstein. We now went on to dream up a nature so far from familiar human experiences to boggle the mind, and you and I are left to wonder when and how we might once again unleash the human mind as we unleashed it two centuries ago. And I think this is a good place for me to quit talking and start listening and see what you all have to say on these ideas. So the floor is yours. Yes, ma'am.
I think it was the second or third step that was the vetting, the initial vetting process.
The third step in that list of five was the step where you sit down with your new idea and you work out the entire details, the framework. You cross-check it. You finish.
Well, then going back to the second one where you air the concept with others. Have you ever talked with others about that it would be helpful that those others you initially talk with are in different fields with different perspectives?
She's asking, should you go to people who are directly in your field or people who are outside it for those that trust? Absolutely outside. Absolutely. If your idea has any validity, it should be more than you can, well, you should be able to say it to somebody who knows more than your very, very narrow language. Yes, I would say that very strongly. And you find that the great minds of the past have all built up coteries of people like that they talk to all the time. You look at LIENHARD, or you look at Einstein, you look at Galileo, they were talking all the time to people all over the map. Yes, sir.
it seems that with the advancement of high technology, the researchers keep catching and catching more problems and not doing solutions.
I'm trying to get the sense of what you're saying.
With high technology, it seems that the researchers are afraid of finishing with all the work that they have to do and catch only problems instead of reaching the solutions.
You're bringing up something that's you must be a researcher. You must be in the business because I recognize it. I had a colleague at the University of Houston who I did a lot of work with, and one of the things that he was exceptionally good at was not allowing me to conclude when I wanted to conclude. And in a way, I had to draw a line under him at some point. But he constantly led me further into problems than I had initially thought I was going to go. So I think the answer to your question is that this is a balancing act. And there are some people who are deathly afraid of ever drawing a line under it. And there are some people who want to draw a line under it immediately. And common sense is going to militate toward a conclusion somewhere. but this is problem dependent. I certainly can't give you a general answer, but you are pointing to a situation that comes up often. You know. And one that I have never heard raised in a forum like this before. Yes, ma'am, you had one over there. Didn't you have one?
I did. You said the first step is allowing the idea to come and that's often done in a quiet place.
Yes.
Do you think that the way technology has taken over our every waking hour, perhaps there's no time for the idea to come?
You raised the question as to whether or not we're able to find those lonely spots. And I think, you know the Myers-Briggs test? The Myers-Briggs test talks how we prepare to gain information, how we gain information, how we process information, and how we dispose of information. This gentleman asked about how we dispose of information. Now you're over here asking how we prepare. There are powerfully extroverted people who can't be away from human contact for a moment. That makes it very hard to do that. There are powerfully introverted people who can never get to step two. Again, his was a balancing act, yours is a balancing act. Are the new electronic media driving us toward a new kind of extrovertism? I don't know the answer to that, but maybe that's something I think that's something that's spinning out. I think the human psyche is going to demand alone space. I think it's going to demand it. But we're in transition as far as the electronic media are concerned, yes. Yes, sir.
Hi, I was wondering if you said we almost create nature by dreaming nature. Is there a place for almost a childlike sense of imagination, of fantasy, rather than just rules of physics and nature, where we imagine something so far-fetched, or we have a persistence that's just unyielding, where imagination...
Of course there is. Of course there is. That's the reason I said that invention has to be the enemy. Creativity has to be the enemy because the world out there has to be step up and put the brakes on you, on us, on me, when we speak nonsense. Yeah. But at the same time, have you read Thomas Kuhn's book on the structure of scientific revolution? You should if you can. It's a wonderful book, and in it, he says something very like what the Romantics are saying. He says that when we move to a new scientific paradigm, not only science changes, but nature changes as well. And we are not living in the same natural world that we thought we were. So, in a way, what I'm saying is metaphor. In a way, I'm saying it has tactual, it has functional truth. Yes, sir.
Hello. Thinking about education, and thinking like where my kids will go to school and the educational system, there's a big push to math and science. You were saying something along that you need a sense of beauty really to be a well-shaped, rounded human being. So how do we, I mean, it looks like you need both from what you were saying. So in school, they teach you a lot of math, a lot of science, and I'm an engineer myself, so I've been raised through a lot of those. But so how these two go together, and how do you get to...
If you're an engineer, did your bachelor's degree here in the United States?
No, I did.
In Europe?
In Europe.
Where?
Italy.
So you've got a different structure there, which I don't know and can't really comment on. In the United States, everybody who graduates from college does so with a bachelor's degree. The bachelor's degree has one objective, to endow us with an education in the liberal arts. What does that mean? It means the education that will prepare us to become functional, free citizens of our country, of the world. I know that in Great Britain you sort of finish your general education at the O level, at the A level, which is kind of almost through junior college, and then you do 3 years of engineering. Perhaps the Italian system works like that, I'm not sure. But in the United States, the real sort of basis for an engineering education was laid in the early 19th century, early to mid-19th century, and then Congress passed a law requiring that every state should be given a huge packet of land that they could sell, a packet of land for each representative, and that the money thus raised would form a university that would train its populace in the agricultural and mechanical arts without losing sight of, I forget exactly the wording, the humanities. So that actually was written into law in 1864, I think it was, the Morrill Act. And every state has its land grant university. I graduated from Oregon State College, now Oregon State University, which had formerly been Oregon Agricultural and Mechanical College. That concept of an education that will not let us emerge monolithically is something that's built in America. It may be slipping. But at least it's a concept that's pretty universal at this point. And you know, in answer to your question, yeah, of course, an education that loses sight, that teaches engineers to lose sight of the side of the other stuff is misbegotten. That is a long answer to a short question, sorry.
So I'm an engineer as well. I do research. And the questions I have with respect to the inventions that you mentioned and nowadays, which puzzled me a lot, is it seems to me that at a certain point in time, there was an invention that served a need, as you said.
Yeah.
Now it seems to me that, and this is one of the reasons why I did my PhD instead of finishing in my undergrad, is that we create some needs so that certain things that we have thought maybe fill them. And it seems to me that at a level of things that we actually need, we get to a point where we're content with what we have, you know, with respect of, you know, structures and, you know, it seems more we play Lego with the basic needs that we have because we already have the pieces, and if, then we don't...
If I may quote Hausman, A. Hausman, the tree of man is never quiet. And the need to invent is so built in. The idea that we come to that we'll come to some sort of homeostasis is, it isn't going to happen. I had a question from a person, an email question this morning that gave me a pause. He said, why haven't we encountered alien species? Maybe it's because every alien species becomes so intelligent that it destroys itself. That's a lurking possibility, but there we've always created need by inventing. And you might say, okay, what would you say to somebody in Byzantium in the year 500 if he had offered what you just said? What would you say to him? You're not there yet, wouldn't you? Right? You're looking at me, you're thinking. I think that to some extent we still live in the Stone Age. We still live in the Stone Age. And the question is whether we can survive our constant invention. I hope so, but it isn't going to quit, and it's been this way all through the history of Homo sapiens. Yes, sir.
There's a quote that I don't know who to attribute to that I've always loved, which is that anything man has ever imagined, he's eventually built. And on that quote, I have a question, which is it in our nature to always be imagining and trying to do everything better, to find a better way?
Yeah, of course, I think, yeah, isn't it?
I think it is.
I think it is, yeah, I'm sure it is.
So we'll never stop, will we?
I read the book of Genesis, and that's what I get out of it. Is that true? That we've eaten the apple, and we have kicked ourselves out of Eden. And the Eden that you hope for, the homeostasis, the steady state, we're constantly kicking ourselves out of Eden.
When it comes to the first step, right, the arrival of the idea.
Yes.
The way you describe this, and I kind of relate to it as well, it's almost like you're reaching out and you feel something and you pick it up. It's and that becomes your idea. It's like you didn't really create it. It was there all along, and you kind of like almost received it as a gift. Does that relate to how you understand it, or is this like, is there really creativity?
That's kind of Alexander Pope's notion of Newton, I think. We carry a jumbled attic up here with all sorts of junk in it. The creative mind hooks this piece of junk over to this piece of junk, when we never thought there was any connection, and creates something new, creates a new idea, creates a new thing, whatever. I don't view this as something given to us. I view it as something that a connection that we've made. And for that reason, I think that memory is extremely important. Carry junk in your mind. Memorize poetry, music, numbers, football scores. Memorize. They all hook together somewhere if you see it. Yes, sir.
Hi. Are you familiar with who Andrew Wiles is?
Who?
Andrew Wiles.
Yeah.
He's Fermat. He proved Fermat's last theorem by locking himself in his room for 7 years and thinking it over. So you provide a number of examples of people who have come to sparks of creative genius by chance, or not necessarily by chance, but in a dream, or like one flash of genius. And I think I provide an example of someone who has labored over a problem for a number of years. Do you think there's any difference between these two different types of people? And if so, what is the difference?
I think that Andrew Wiles spent an enormous amount of time in stage two. I mean, I think the invention and the creativity was there. He spent an enormous amount of time in stage two, writing. How thick is his paper? You know, it's immense. Which, by the way, leads us to wonder whether Fermat actually did have a solution that he couldn't quite write in the margins. But that's another question. But I think that what you're seeing there is stage two of the process that I've been describing. There was somebody way back here, behind. Yes, sir.
I wanted to explore this kind of between one and two, and maybe it gets to what you were saying about the 7 years in your bedroom. Is there a need for tension or fear that you're onto something but you can't get it? You have to be afraid that someone will find it first, or you told someone you could do it and you can't. You need that challenge to spark you to come up with this connection.
All of the above. I think, wait a minute. Two things going here. Once you've got the idea, then all of these fears are going to be present. Will somebody steal the idea? Will it fizzle? Is it turned out it's going to be a flop? That's why you desperately need to have a few people you can trust that you can kind of air things with. Desperately important. And that, by the way, is one of the reasons that I'm extremely leery of brainstorming. Because the brainstorming groups are ad hoc thrown together. And what people do, they create their own tiny community around them, creative people. And I think that brainstorming is an attempt to bottomless and sell it. Let's see. You have a question? Anything for you? Okay, yes.
So when you said that the design for the finance museum, the museum, your example in the museum, you said that you speak about this openness, this human disposition, this openness to be changed, no?
Yes.
So how this plays in the invention? How does it happen in the invention, this openness to be changed? This dynamic, what does it mean and how does it happen?
I was attempting to give examples with Mary Shelley. Her openness was a business of simply working a conversation and reworking it and not closing it off, not saying, conversation's over, now I'm going to go to sleep. But rather, is there more here? Let it rattle around. The same thing with Kekulé and his benzene molecule. I thought about that. Now I'm going to cook supper and watch television. I think the openness means that you're able to remember your problem, keep it cooking, even double. I know that I've gotten an awful lot of my good ideas sitting in concerts, focusing on the music, but letting the thing kind of kick around. That's really what I mean by openness. If it makes sense, I hope it makes sense. Yes?
I've got the mic here, so.
Just a moment. But I just want to do a thing. We've gone till 7:30. How long do you want to run? I'm not shutting you off, no. How long do you want to run?
Eight.
Yeah. Well, okay, give me a minute. Go ahead.
It's interesting. It's, well, one, my comment, whoever made that quote of everything we imagine and we make, that sounds frightening to me. Of God willing, we imagine things that we simply behold and we know we can't make.
Yep.
And I think that speaks to something that I hear from you, is this creative process has this paradoxical tension of separating yourself into a quiet, but at the same time communing, which is a kind of a deeper, seems to me, is kind of a deeper tuning, a deeper listening, which also points to that there's something greater out there that we're tuning into, that we must behold.
I don't sense a question here, rather I sense your own summary.
I'm on some of the, eventually
so far,
a question. So I think this process of kind of deeper tuning, of listening, that kind of paradoxical tension, that's, as creatures of habit, that takes work, takes exercise, and someone had mentioned something about education. And in the world of education, are we able to practice that from the young age to the old, and perhaps in college we can have more seminars, but it seems to me that there's a bit of a crisis in education, that's not allowed to be practiced, and can you speak on that?
Well, I've taught since 1952, and I've done well and I've done poorly. And one thing that I came to see as perhaps my most important ability as a teacher was knowing how to deal with students' questions and responses in the class. How do you elicit them? How do you listen to them? How do you process them? How do you make them work for the other students? I think that's, for any kind of a teacher, I think that's profoundly important. And even if you're dealing with a huge mega section of 800 people where discussion is impossible, you still have to be running those conversations in your own mind as though they were happening. Does that make sense? You've got to be listening to questions that you're not hearing and dealing with them. I think that's extremely important. Is that the answer? Is that what you were...
Yeah, I think that's it. Yeah. Especially the process of making, the very process of making.
Yes.
Thank you for the talk. Do you think there's a limitation for what the human mind will ever be able to understand about the universe?
Is what?
There's a limitation to what the human mind
limitation.
Will ever understand about, let's say, the universe.
Yes. I look at physics and I look at the way the universe has opened up in my lifetime, and it is absolutely scary. It seems to me that every answer generates far more.